Welcome back to Birds and Swords. We're coming to you from our Milwaukee studio. It's been a minute. We got Alyssa here with us. How you doing, Alyssa?
I'm doing great. And you?
I am doing amazing. I think, first of all, since it's been a while, we need a bird update. Bird update. Obviously, Laszlo's still amazing, right?
He's so cute. I guess our latest bird update would be that we took McCreary to the vet. So
is McCreary the oldest of the birds? Is he the elder bird?
No, that would probably be Taz. Taz would be the oldest.
Why does McCreary seem old to me?
He is old, but not as old as Taz.
He's got like a passive personality, like never leaves the cage.
Yeah, very much so. Well, he has tuberculosis. Mm-hmm. We call it tuberculosis. So when he first got diagnosed, he had like a little tumor under his eye, and we kept getting it removed, and it kept growing back. So we got all these tests done, and $5,000 later, we found out,
$5,000?
Yeah.
His life is worth that?
Oh, absolutely. He is my baby. Right. So he was actually given to me by a very close friend before my friend committed suicide. So I will hold on to this bird with my life.
Okay.
I value the bird's life outside of that, but it's also that like...
There's an extra connection there.
Yeah, absolutely. So $5,000 of testing, and we found out that he has tuberculosis, which is really rare in birds. But he has it, and they removed the tumor, and he's on medication.
So what is tuberculosis?
That's a great question. I don't really know. They just said he has it and gave us meds for it.
So it's not cancer, but he had a tumor?
Yeah, it was like part of the illness was that he kept growing a tumor under his eye. But now that he's on the meds, it doesn't grow there anymore. So I'm not really sure.
Originally to the point where you could see it?
Yeah, it was like a big tumor. It was like underneath his eyelid, and they kept removing it surgically. And eventually they were like, something is going wrong here. So tuberculosis was the case. And he's doing really good now. So we took him in for his annual checkup to Niles Animal Hospital, the best animal hospital in the Midwest.
That's in Illinois.
Yes. Right? Yep.
Niles, Illinois. So how old is McCreary?
He's got to be at least like 13.
You don't know.
No, because he was given to me by a friend, so I don't know his actual age, but I think he's got to be around 13.
He's a tween.
Yeah. Yeah, he's such a good boy. He's so good. But we took him in for his annual checkup, and the vet said his diagnosis is that he's a handsome boy.
Oh, really?
No shit?
He said that exactly?
Yeah, it was so sweet. So he's doing really great. His meds are working. It's not that you can cure tuberculosis, but you can kind of like subside the symptoms. So he's really good, really healthy. He's doing great. He acts like a normal bird. Like he's not ill at all. So, because when I first took him in, they wanted me to put him down and I absolutely refused.
Wow. It was to that point?
Yeah. They said that, like, they were like, you're going to spend, because I spend about probably $500 on meds a month on him.
That's rent for some people.
I know. So I am all in for this bird, this little cockatiel baby.
Well, so he's 13-ish, tuberculosis, the 500 covers all the birds? They've all got issues?
No, that's just him.
That's just him?
Yeah.
So how much do you spend a month,
on all the birds? Probably like 7.
Really?
Yeah.
Because which other ones need meds?
So Taz has uterus problems, so Taz is a girl. Taz has uterus problems and severe arthritis, but some of the meds that we give Taz, we also give McCreary, like pain meds, so they're kind of interchangeable. And then Laszlo has an enlarged heart, so we give him meds for that.
No!
He's got a big
heart. I didn't know that.
He's just such a lover.
Wow. He's my new best friend.
I love that bird.
We've been doing like all the Marquette coverage for the barn and stuff, so I've been sliding by like after we go to Marquette games and stuff because they're just right down there. So I go and hang out with Laszlo for even if it's just like 20-30 minutes.
Yeah.
But he always spends time with me while I'm there. I know I'm like a new person.
He loves you.
A new person or whatever, but I like to think that he loves me.
He does.
Also.
He's such a lover.
And he loves my ears. He's always in my ear. Like earlobe, or he likes wants to take care of shit. I don't know.
He's so funny. I love that little baby.
I love him. I haven't spent a lot of time with McCreary. He doesn't seem to leave the cage much.
He's not super social. He really is just in love with Taz. They're bonded. So
yeah, Taz, I guess, doesn't leave the cage much either.
Yeah, well, the arthritis will do that. So Taz will leave to forage on the floor once in a while. But then once Taz wants to go back in the cage, Taz will start going like, pew, pew.
So the arthritis affects like flight more than anything? Or
The feet more than anything. The arthritis is in like the knees. So when Taz wants to go back in the cage, like, she'll start pewing, and then we'll put her back in the cage. She, like, lets us know.
Mm-hmm.
But the wings, not so much, but she's, like, a heavy girl, so she doesn't fly very well. She kind of goes, rrr.
Just chills out.
Yeah.
Just chills out. I love the birds. Love the birds so much.
Yeah.
So thanks for the update. Otherwise, they're all doing well. Yes.
Yes, they're all doing amazing.
Good. Even the fucking dinosaurs.
Oh my god.
Conyards.
I couldn't get them in the cage today when I was trying to come here for the podcast. They kept trying to bite my toes, and they wouldn't let me pick them up.
They're so weird. I was over there last night because we went to the Marquette Selection Sunday event, and they're just always together, and we talked about how they were like raptors,
like a hydra.
They're like pack hunters. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like they have one body and their heads are just...
They're just like a unit.
Yeah. And they're like always like that.
Yeah.
They will leave their cage and like go to the other one and sit on the top or the side or whatever. But they're always just together. It's just so weird. It's like the most primal form of animal or something.
Did you see the Snapchat I posted where they were in my hair?
No.
Oh, I'll have to show it to you. Maybe I'll post it on Birds and Swords. It's like I took a Snapchat and it just looks like a normal like video of me like, ooh, nice makeup. And then you see the mirror behind me and they're all in the back of my hair holding on, all three of them.
Wow.
Yeah. Always accessorize.
Yeah. They're the closest thing to dinosaurs that I've seen in the modern era.
Yeah.
So weird. All right, this is a video game podcast. Let's talk about video games.
Yeah.
So your mom had, you invited me up to your mom's house. We kind of played some video games, shot some pool, just kind of a laid back thing with some friends and stuff.
Yeah.
I think I ate some sausage.
Oh, the food was so good. I had so many sliders.
A little bit of a spread. Yeah, I was going to say the sliders too.
Yeah.
But anyway, we started out the night playing some Mario Kart.
Yeah.
Right? So we played some Mario Kart. We didn't do like the drunk Birio Kart or whatever anybody calls
it. I mean,
it.
I was drunk, but it wasn't like that, you know?
Yeah. But it got to a point where everybody's like, you know, I'm good. I'm going to throw some darts or get a refill, take a shot, whatever. So I think it was just me and Sid sitting there, and I was just going through your games. And I asked you what Road 96 was, and you got super excited to tell me. And even in recollection, I think you've talked about it on the podcast.
I have, before, on the Indie Game podcast.
Yeah. So you got all excited. I remember reacting to like, whoa, someone wants me to play. But it didn't seem like a game for the moment. So you recommended that I play Untitled Goose Game.
Yeah.
Which I have never played, actually. I think you've talked about it on the podcast also. And it's been out for years and years and years. I don't even know when it came out, like 2012 or something.
Yeah,
probably,
a while ago.
But it's downloaded on your Switch, and your Switch was there. So I played some Untitled Goose Game, and it's super fun because, well, first of all, let me comment on the side-eyeing goose thing. So whatever coding they have to where the goose, like if a human's around, like his head follows the human and like side eyes the whole time. It is hilarious.
Always squaring up with the people in the vicinity.
Yeah. So would you describe the game as you're just fucking with people, right?
Yes, you're literally a goose. Like you have a laundry list of things to do in each area that is specifically to fuck with the humans, like steal their glasses, steal their hat. Like it's just things to like make the people mad, which is such goose behavior. So it's so funny. And it was hilarious watching you play it. And at one point, like everybody at the party was like in it. They were like, he's got a knife.
Yeah, that was the funniest part. So I was in like a garden. It's like the very first area. So you're supposed to, there's like a checklist of things to do to mess with this gardener guy. But there's also like tools that he has like on one of the back barrier things. And one of them, and I think it's like a shovel, but it looks like a knife, especially when it's in your mouth. So you're playing as the goose, and you can pick up things in your mouth and drop it somewhere or interact with something somewhere. So I picked, it ended up everybody at the bar behind us, because the basement's pretty cool there. There's like a built-in bar and stuff. So they were watching me play, and I didn't have any idea that they were watching me play, and I picked up one of the knives, and all of a sudden I just hear someone from the background go, oh my God, he's got a knife! Like, I was just on my way to murder someone.
I was, like, upstairs at that moment, and I came down from, like, going to the bathroom, and I was, like, I sat down and watched you play, and everybody was cheering, and I, like, turned around to see what was going on, and they were all watching you, like, the whole party
watching
you play. It was so
funny. Freaking goose game. It's very fetch questy, but I did like it just because of its, you know, a little bit nonsensical, like you're just, you know, messing with people.
Yeah,
is your checklist.
And there is a story you didn't get far enough you really actually don't realize there's a story until like the last level, but there is like a really great, like, maybe not story, but message about how we love chaos and how we should appreciate geese and their chaotic nature.
Yeah, so. Well, we could talk about geese too, because geese are, I don't know if they're on an island as far as birds go, but they like don't give a fuck about humans, like what you want. Like they're kind of mean, right? Yeah.
So I actually,
territorial.
I say this all the time, so you've probably heard me say this, but I actually want to be reincarnated as a goose so bad. Like when I come back, I want to be a fucking goose.
Just you could mess with people.
Yeah, I want to like bite kids.
Other animals.
You ever see the inside of a goose?
I want to bite kids. It's my lifelong dream. I want to bite children.
You ever see the inside of a goose's mouth? A goose's mouth. They have like teeth.
Oh yeah. I think you showed me something.
I want
before.
That for myself.
And not just teeth, like 60 sharp. On the bottom, 60 on the top, like full throttle.
I want to fuck with people. It's like I want to be a goose so bad. They are. Geese and swans are just like birds to not be fucked with, really.
So the game kind of mimics that because like the gardener guy was carrying a set of keys like on a key ring on his hip and you can like steal them and then you run away. So it kind of gets intense because you're like, get to the water. Yeah. He can't go in the water. So
and then he could.
You've got the keys in your mouth and he's chasing you with like a shovel, like just ready to
and
hit
then
you.
Then he like kicks you and shit. Yeah. Like, it was rude.
So interesting game.
You gotta beat it. Now you gotta come over and finish it.
Yeah, I need to finish it.
It's so good. I love that game. And now you can understand the memes because you've probably seen the memes where it's like the goose from Untitled Goose Game with a knife in his mouth and it says peace was never an option.
Yep.
I want, and you can play two player too.
Yeah, I saw that was an option, but I didn't know how it worked.
So I was so excited about this game when it originally came out. Zach actually bought it thinking it was just an app for your phone and got two player for us, but it was too choppy, like it wouldn't run well on our phones. So I told him, I was like, I really appreciate that you did this, but I actually want it for the Switch. So then he bought it for me on the Switch, which was really nice of him. So I played it single player without him.
And so did I.
Yeah.
I did as well. I benefited from that as well. Quirky, fun game, though. Really leans into the goose nature of just messing with people and not giving a shit.
Yes.
That's kind of how geese are. Like, if you ever driven down the road and had to, like, wait for geese to cross the road and stuff, like, they don't care.
They just don't care. They just waddle along.
I don't know if there's more in Wisconsin because we have more water, at least kind of in this area.
Especially in the Milwaukee area.
Yeah, I feel like there probably are more here.
So many because I take Lincoln Memorial right along the lake every day when I go to work, and there's like hundreds of geese, and I'm like, I am one of you.
Yeah. What else do we do? Actually, before we go to break, and we're going to, in the second segment, we're going to talk about some games that, you want to explain all that?
Yeah. You
had better terminology for it than I did.
So this episode was my idea, and I was thinking we'd talk about games that surprised us in good and bad ways. So games that maybe we came across and were not expecting them to be so good, or stumbled across and ended up being amazing. And also games that disappointed us. Maybe they had really high marketing budgets, or maybe someone recommended it to you and you were just like, this is not it. So on both ends of the spectrum of it was a surprising game experience.
Okay. Which is good topic.
Thank you.
Because that happens all the time to everybody, especially if you play a lot.
Yeah.
A lot of diverse games like you and I like to play.
Yeah. And there will be some hot takes. I feel like I'll have a few games that people will really disagree with me on, and that is okay.
Yes. Hot takes are great. Hey, I got a couple of rapid fire bullshit questions, though. Random questions.
Okay.
These are fun. So before we go to break, real quick, which is part of where I think you got this idea. Here's a popular one. If you had to marry the last video game character you played, who would it be?
It would be my own character in Baldur's Gate.
Really? And you'd be all right with that?
I don't know, because kind of in a weird, weird way, in a weird self-reflective way, because I made her to look like...
it is you. It's like
I made her like a hot version of me, so I'm like, she's hot, but I tried to make her look like me. So,
unless she's like doing her meditating thing. She looks weird when she does that.
Yeah, well, you know, then, yeah. At least I didn't eat the tadpole, because then you should see Sid's character. It's all fucked up. But what about you?
What do you mean fucked up?
So in Baldur's Gate, later on in the game, you have the ability to become like really powerful if you eat this like specific tadpole, but it makes you look really ugly. And you have to roll really high not to eat it so you can stay pretty. And I did, and Sid didn't. So Sid's character is kind of like fucked up looking now.
How fucked up. Like,
so basically,
undead,
like,
or something?
Yeah, like undead, like your eyes are black, and then it's like all like you're all pale, and it's all like your veins are black. And yeah, undead is a good terminology, probably. It's not horrific. Like, I would still be into it if I came across
it. I was going to say, it sounds kind of hot.
It sounds like kind of my style.
Sounds like bleeding mascara.
Yeah. You know? That's kind of exactly the look. It's not horrible, but most people are like, I wish I didn't do this to my character. So.
They want to do over.
Yeah. So who would yours be then?
Mine would be like one of the four girls in Persona. You don't really play as them, though.
Yeah, but that counts.
And I don't, even though I'm in like the third area, I don't have like full opinions of them yet.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's hard for me to pick one.
I mean, if we do that, then I could romance any of my Baldur's Gate babies.
Yeah. I hear a lot about Shadowheart. Everybody wants, and what's the step on me?
Karlach. Yeah.
Yeah. The chick
with the... Gale is still my wifey, but he's getting a little needy, so I'm like,
I keep seeing memes about that. Like,
I know, because nobody picks him because everybody thinks he's so like cringy, and I'm like, do I have a type?
What? Okay, here's another one. What is the longest amount of time you've played a game nonstop, do you think? And how long?
Like, nonstop?
I'll actually go first on this one,
because
I did a benefit for... Wisconsin Children's Hospital, where we did a 24-hour gaming marathon.
Is that through GameStop?
Kind of. It was through some people I knew with GameStop. I don't think we...
I feel like I remember this vaguely.
Yeah, we didn't like pull in a GameStop affiliation or anything, but it was people that I befriended through GameStop. We did a full 24-hour gaming marathon. Now, I played multiple games, but I remember it was right when I was loving Overwatch. So it was easy. Like, I played like 14 of those hours. I probably played Overwatch.
Yeah.
That's definitely my longest run of games at a time. I did play some other games. I think I played a couple sports games. We streamed it all. Sponsor had people donate and stuff. And it was an awesome event because we raised money for the hospital. But I think Overwatch was probably the longest run I've ever done at one time. Now, there's older games, because back in the day, you couldn't save games. You have to turn for TV and turn it back on. I don't know what those game times look like if you added them up. But, like, at one time, Overwatch, and it was probably more than 12 hours in one, like, sitting. Maybe a couple bathroom breaks or whatever, but...
Yeah.
I think Overwatch for me.
I think Overwatch for me, too. When I first started dating Zach, we played that nonstop. Like, I would go when he lived on in his place on Paradise. We would play that. Like, I would get off from class when I was in college, and we would, like, play that from night to morning. Probably, like, at least 12 hours. Like, nonstop. I mean, yeah, bathroom breaks and stuff, but, like, it was nonstop. We would play through, like, the weekend. We would sleep for a few hours and then play another 12.
It took over the world. The gaming world. It really did.
It was so much fun. That original Overwatch was, like, something to beat, really.
Yeah, and I think probably the closest things to it was maybe, for me, Borderlands. We had a lot of heavy nights of Borderlands because I played that with four people co-op, which is the max you can do. And we played through all of Borderlands, too. So there's probably some nights where we pushed, like, 6 to 8 hours, you know, in one run.
I feel like the next for me would be like the Until Dawn game. I played with my friends a couple times and we always played all the way through, and that's like an 8 to 10 hour game.
Oh, you like did an entire playthrough?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Overwatch, I think, has a beat because, I mean, it feels like 15 minutes and it's been like 5 hours.
Yeah, it was hard to stop playing.
Yeah. It's especially those freaking loot boxes.
Loot boxes. And that formula was so good because you didn't have to be like amazing at FPSs in order to be successful.
Yeah.
You could be a healer. There were so many, you know, defensive strategies and stuff.
Who was your main?
Moira for me, which she was a healer, but she had really high DPS too.
Yeah.
And she had high agility.
She was OP for sure.
I was just really good with her.
Yeah.
So Moira for sure. And I even have her sticker.
Oh, yeah.
On my laptop.
She was so awesome.
All right. Last one before break. If video games didn't exist anymore, what would you do instead with that time?
Oh, I can answer this easily. True crime documentaries and reading true crime books. That's like what I mean.
That's already like a high percentage of your week, probably.
Yeah. So actually, I probably do more of that than video games, disgracefully, right now, because when I get home from work, I'm actually just like so mentally exhausted. I don't even game.
Yeah.
I put on a true crime documentary or read a true crime book.
Not disgracefully. Do what makes you happy.
Yeah. Well, I love gaming. It's
Yeah.
It's just, it gets like more draining.
I'm like that too. You got to be in a different like mindset.
Ready to enter the world.
Even if it's casual or intense or whatever, I feel like you have to be in the mood to play games. And sometimes I'm like that too. I just want to watch something.
Yeah. I feel like yours is sports.
Yeah, I go to sports. Quite a bit. Quite a bit. I love sports so much. That would probably be my answer. Yeah, sports or maybe more creative stuff, you know, creating videos and shit. Yeah, all the stuff we do for the barn. But mostly I would probably watch more things because I really don't watch a ton of TV.
Yeah.
I have stuff recommended to me all the time. I'm like, yeah, the only time I have TV on is like when I'm multitasking or eating and it's like The Office or Everybody Loves Raymond or Parks and Rec. Shit I've seen before that I know I don't have to pay too much attention to, but I can still get enjoyment of it out of the background. And sports works in the same way where you can have it on in the background while I'm doing other things.
I do say to Zach a lot that if video games didn't exist, I'd be a much, much more productive artist. In the sense that I literally produce more art, but I don't regret my time with video games at all. I think that they're so good for my mental health. But for sure, I would probably be like way more up there with my art if I wasn't consumed in video games.
Be a more productive person, probably.
But I'd also be way more depressed. So it's a win for me, really.
And if you compare it to a lot of other people's TV time, like it's the same. And at least gaming, you're like interactive or get to make choices.
Yeah.
Or you're even, you know, your coordination or.
And there's a community for it too, which is really fun.
Yeah. All right. Good times catching up. We're going to take a break. We're going to come back with some games that surprised us. We're brought to you by www.betterhelp.com/the barn, Healthy Hemp Gear, and Black Bayou Coffee Roasters. We'll be back right after this.
You are listening to Micah and Alyssa on Birds and Swords. Please like, subscribe, turn on notifications, and smash that like button.
Thank you to BetterHelp for sponsoring this episode. BetterHelp is the world's largest therapy service, and it's 100% online. With BetterHelp, you can tap into a network of over 25,000 licensed and experienced therapists who can help you with a wide range of issues. To get started, you just answer a few questions about your needs and preferences in therapy. That way, BetterHelp can match you with the right therapist from their network. Then you can talk to your therapist however you feel comfortable, whether it's via text, chat, phone, or video call. You can message your therapist at any time and schedule live sessions when it's convenient for you. If your therapist isn't the right fit for any reason, you can switch to a new therapist at no additional charge. With BetterHelp, you get the same professionalism and quality you expect from in-office therapy, but with a therapist who is custom-picked for you, more scheduling flexibility, and at a more affordable price. Get 10% off your first month at betterhelp.com/the barn. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/the barn.
Welcome back to Birds and Swords. This segment, do you want to explain what this segment is?
Okay, so games that surprised us in a good way and a bad way. So games that we went into maybe not knowing much about or just picked up off the shelf and they ended up being a really pleasant surprise. And games that disappointed us. Maybe they had really a lot of marketing or a game that was recommended by a friend that you just were really disappointed in.
Yeah, or like pre-ordered it like 7 months out and paid the full $60 or $70 for.
Yeah.
Okay, which one do you want to start with?
The surprised us.
Okay.
In a good way.
Okay. Can I go first?
Yes, please.
Subnautica.
Oh my gosh.
Subnautica.
Good one.
I'm usually not that, well, maybe I am kind of that kind of gamer because I like detailed checklisty things.
But yeah.
Subnautica is almost, it's kind of like a Minecraft, like you have to figure out your way as you go and like build a.
I loved watching Zach play it.
Strong base, but there's so much exploration that game is so cool and it's so well done, has great music. You kind of just figure out your way. There's no story. You only gather the information that you need and where to go through like these audio recordings.
Yeah.
And there's only like 20 of them, you know, in the whole game. But it's so mysterious because most people, including myself, are kind of fearful of the dark ocean. Like
I am.
We still haven't discovered like 70% of it or whatever it is.
Terrifying.
You know what I mean? It's like there's fucking aliens down there. So there's a lot of that that goes with it where there's this spooky horror aspect of, you know, going deeper and deeper. Plus, you have to gather materials to craft your ship so you can even go deeper and deeper. So it's this big progression system. But I didn't think I was going to be into something like that, and I super, super was. I love Subnautica, love the exploration.
Did you beat it?
Yep.
That's awesome. Oh, yep. That's so cool.
And there's Leviathans, which are like the big scary things, and it's only so often, but you figure out where they are and what depth they're at and stuff like that. Super creepy game, super awesome. You get to build a fort, so there's some customization, you know, stronghold type of stuff there. Love Subnautica. So you didn't play Subnautica, you just watched?
I watched Zach play it. Okay. But that's such a good one because I also, not even playing it, felt the same way where I was like, this is kind of weird. And then the further Zach got into it, the more engaged I was with him, like watching that. It's just really incredible. It's just so open world exploration and you just like upgrade your stuff so you can keep exploring further. It's just so cool.
Yeah. And there's like a claustrophobic element to it because you're in like, it's all in first person, but you craft like these little submarines eventually where you can go down under and it still feels suffocating.
Yeah.
Yet free and explorative. And yeah, it's just so good.
It's so interesting that you brought that one up too, because before this episode, I was kind of on a Reddit thread looking up like inspiration to kind of get my gears going to think of like what I would think of. And a lot of people on that subreddit said Subnautica. Like a lot of people felt the same way as you.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a really good one.
And that it's like a popular game with like 12-year-old kids.
Yeah.
But
Fits in for us.
I swear, whatever age you are, you would enjoy Subnautica if you haven't played it yet. And that game's been out a long time too, since like 2012. But you can get it on like every platform. But Subnautica, so good. So good.
All right. So I for mine is actually going to be the Lego Indiana Jones.
Oh.
Which yes.
The tattoo, right?
I literally have a tattoo.
Was that your first tattoo?
No, it was not. It was like fifth.
It's got to be close.
It was like my fifth.
Really?
Yeah. It's actually a father-daughter tattoo, so let me explain the story.
Okay.
So when my biological dad bought me the Xbox 360 for Christmas one year. It came with a dual game pack. It was Kung Fu Panda and Lego Indiana Jones. And we put that game in, Lego Indiana Jones, and I have never laughed so hard in my life. Like, it was the funniest, newest game genre.
This was probably like 2007 or 8, I would guess. Gosh,
I was young. I was like...
Xbox came out in 2006, I want to say.
Yeah, it was...
Probably short. It was an early release game. Yeah. 2007, 2006, you were born in what?
94. What's that math?
4, so you're like 22?
22. No.
Like 17, yeah.
What is that math? No, it's earlier than that. Okay. How do I do the math? We can cut this out.
2010, you would have been 14. So yeah, you'd have been 11 or 12.
Okay. Yeah. So I was like, yeah, that sounds right. Early teens.
Yeah.
And it was just the funniest freaking game. It was the first Lego game I've ever played. One of the first to come out, I think. And it just was absolutely hilarious. They had no voice acting at the time, and the way that they just broke apart and replayed the Indiana Jones movies, like, it was just so hysterical. And it was just like the greatest bonding moment between me and my dad, to the point where when I turned 18, I got Lego Indiana Jones tattooed on my arm and he got Lego Short Round.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So he has Lego Short Round tattooed on, father-daughter tattoo.
That's awesome.
I know. It was literally one of the best memories of my whole life. And it's funny because when I first got the Xbox, I played Kung Fu Panda thinking Lego Indiana Jones was going to freaking suck. And he's like, let's just give it a try.
Yeah, it's the opposite.
Yep. It was just one of the best games. And it actually led to so much bonding between me and my biological dad, because we played after that Lego Star Wars and Lego Harry Potter and all the other Lego games. It was like our bonding. So
that's just awesome.
An incredible surprise. I'll never let that go.
That's amazing. I think it was, man, if it wasn't the first, I think one of the Lego Star Wars might have been the very first. Don't quote me on that. We're not experts on the Lego chronological order. But the original Indiana Jones was near the beginning. And I do remember it being on like a dual disc
set
with Kung Fu Panda.
So good.
Interesting.
Do you have another?
I do. And you'll like this one because it's actually The Sims. So I didn't think I'd like The Sims.
Oh, The Sims 1?
Yeah, I don't even know what year this is, right? So I don't know where we are. It goes way back to like original PC. And, you know, I always had shitty laptops or whatever.
Yeah.
So I think probably The Sims 2.
That's where I started too.
Right? So I remember I made a really poor white trash family and like leaned into just being as shitty as I could. Like my whole house was brown. You know, just regular tube TV. Like my point was...
You didn't have the mother load code yet.
No, I didn't. I think I did, but I didn't care. Like I really wanted to simulate, like I really leaned into it because I didn't think I would... You know, like a life simulator. And that was probably the first one that I ever played or enjoyed. You know, there's been other kind of life sim, you know, Animal Crossing, shit like
yeah.
that I've been into since. But as a true life sim, I totally didn't think I'd be into it. It was one of those recommended by friends. It was like, just give it a chance. So it's like, install the disc. And you could like go to Walmart or Target or Best Buy and buy like expansions for $19.99.
Yep, I used to do that.
Like a disc for everyone.
Ugh.
So I had a couple of those. I think I date night because I was like, well, I got to see what
nightlife. Yes, yeah, that's like, the one. I got to see
what that is about. So I didn't think I would be into that, but the entry cost wasn't a lot. So I went out and bought it and played it and then ended up really, really liking it because like I said, I leaned into this trope of that. I was like, I'm going to be a poor white trash family and see how far I can get. I don't remember what my job was. It was something super shitty. I know at the beginning... You can be like a newspaper reporter or something. I might have been a newspaper reporter and then just like turn down every promotion that they gave me. I was like, nah, I'm good. Like, I'll take the $3,500 a month and we'll make do.
Oh,
this shitty brown recliner.
We could do a whole episode on Sims. We should, honestly.
Yeah, we really could. Yes. We really could.
Oh, and
I enjoyed the life stuff, but I also enjoyed like the architecture of building the house and stuff. I think a lot of people do. So that was a part that at least grabbed me. Probably into the game to enjoy the other things that it offered after with the social life type of stuff. So, The Sims.
That is a good one.
Two, I guess.
Really good one.
Sims 2. A little off-brand for me, but yeah, it built some gaming things after that I really enjoyed because I had already experienced it.
I love that. I guess my next one would be, there was this really cute girl in my middle school, and I was super into her, and she was like, oh my gosh, she had like, think of like really cute, like...
This is real life we're talking
about?
Yeah,
real life. She had like the short pink hair, like really pretty girl, and I wanted to impress her. So she like handed me this video game one day and was like, you should try this. Like, I really like this game. It's so cute and so fun. And I was like, okay, I'll totally give it a try. And I put it in and it ended up being one of the best games I've ever played in my life. This cute little pixie girl, God of War.
What?
Yeah, she gave me fucking God of War.
Which one? The original?
The first one on PlayStation 2. She's like, borrow this. It's such a cute, fun game. And it was like the most intense, slaughtering, like malicious game I've ever played. And I loved it. And she told me too. She's like, if you beat it on hard mode, you get the cow costume and you can beat it. And then cow costume. And I was like, oh my gosh, I'm in love with you. So God of War, because when the first one came out, it became popular fast, but I was in middle school, so I really didn't catch on to that. So when she handed me this game, I really had no idea at all what it was.
God of War.
Yeah. And it blew my freaking mind. And I've been a diehard fan ever since. So that one was definitely one that surprised me. I had no idea what I was going into. Absolutely loved it.
Oh, all kidding aside, that's a pretty life-changing because you got to enjoy all the guys. I mean, I'm sure you would ran across it at some point.
But. Right. But like I was in there right from the beginning just because this cute little pink haired girl was like, this game is so cute and fun.
I can't believe that's how she pitched it.
Yeah, she really did.
Like, no, you're going to be slaying demons for hours.
It's so gory. You're going to kill people to solve puzzles.
Yeah, man. Yeah, that's good. That's good. I'll quickly fire through a couple. Doki Doki Literature Club, which a friend recommended, and I was like, visual novel, I haven't really gotten into that yet. I had already played Persona, so I was cool with the anime and, you know, JRPG kind of aspect of it. But that game's killer. We've talked about it multiple times.
So yes, can't not, good one.
Not mention it, because I still went in a little trepid. You know, I was like, I don't know what this is going to be like. But the more you play it, the more that game sucks you in and fucks with you. And I just loved that whole aspect of it. Another one, kind of a big one, we talked about this like when the podcast started, is Elden Ring.
Ooh.
Not because the reviews weren't positive, because they definitely were, but I just wasn't into Souls likes. You know what I mean? I was like, man, that is not my kind of game.
Yeah.
I did not finish it, but I played a huge chunk of it, and then the freedom that you have, I mean, it's just unparalleled. You just still haven't seen that in any kind of game, so Elden Ring for sure. What else you got?
Rapid fire for me, the first Kingdom Hearts. I came across that because my neighbor had it when I was just really, really young. I had to be like 10, maybe younger. And he was like, do you want to play this Disney game? And he showed it to me and I fell in love with it. And then I didn't come across it again for years because I was just like so young. I didn't really understand what was going on. But that was like my first introduction, was like my neighbor being like, play this Disney game.
Dude, same thing for me. I just saw someone playing.
Yeah.
And I was like, Disney characters?
Yeah.
And hack and slash?
It was so weird. It was so, it like rewired something in my brain.
Final Fantasy guy over here?
Yeah.
So I saw someone playing it. And then I had to get it.
Yeah, that's how it went for me.
And actually, for me, it was Kingdom Hearts 2. It didn't happen until Kingdom Hearts 2.
Oh, it was the first one for me.
So I played Kingdom Hearts 2 before I played Kingdom Hearts 1. And Kingdom Hearts 2 is definitely better than Kingdom Hearts 1. And it's actually the best Kingdom Hearts. Do you disagree?
The second one?
Yeah.
I love that one. I think that's, yeah, agreeable.
I mean, they're all pretty good. Well,
yeah, no,
we'll go more into Kingdom Hearts later.
Yeah.
A little disappointed with Kingdom Hearts 3, but same thing happened to me with watched somebody play. Recommendation type of situation.
I was so young when it was showed to me that during the battle scenes he would actually play, because I like couldn't understand how to like battle. So yeah, it was just crazy.
So how old were you?
I don't know. I was so young. It was when I lived in Barton, and I had to be like, I don't know. When did Kingdom Hearts come out? It had to be so close to when it was released.
Let me check.
Okay.
Kingdom Hearts. Kingdom Heats. I forgot the R. Kingdom Hearts release date. September 17th, 2002.
It had to be so close.
I wasn't exposed to Kingdom Hearts to like 07 or something.
I feel like I was like maybe 8 years old.
Yeah, so. you definitely could have been.
Yeah. So that was my experience with that. Continuing the rapid fire, Final Fantasy X. I was in a GameStop.
Is that still your favorite?
That's my favorite, and that was my introduction to the series. Yeah, I was just in a GameStop and I saw the cover and I really liked it. It had Tidus on it with a sword in the water. And I thought that was really pretty. And I picked it up and I played it and I fell in love with it. I knew nothing about Final Fantasy when I bought that game. I just liked the cover art, which is something I think.
Well, they have those kick-ass CGI cutscenes that were like far and away.
Oh, yeah.
Than anything in video games.
Oh, yeah, yeah. But I feel like that's something that like this newer generation won't necessarily have the same experience with. Like, I would walk into, like, a Blockbuster, a Best Buy, a GameStop, and pick a game out for its pretty cover art. Because of the digital world and because of social media, they don't really have that experience anymore.
Yeah, it was way more important back then. And even in the latter years of physical, because, man, it's almost gone now. I still buy physical. But even in the latter years of physical, the back cover art where you used to get, like, 5 or 6 screenshots.
Yeah.
And maybe a description of the story and a couple
maybe
sentences.
A little gameplay info.
Now it's like an advertisement.
Yeah.
Where it's like one screen of something. And it's like, take over the whatever.
Yeah.
Man.
It's so different.
They've lost that marketing entirely.
Yeah. Absolutely. And then my final one is The Wolf Among Us.
I love The Wolf Among Us. That's my favorite Telltale.
It's so underrated. So I played it because I played The Walking Dead Telltale. And I was like, I really love the layout of this game, the gameplay. So I saw Wolf Among Us that it was by Telltale. And I thought, I'll give this a try. And it ended up being one of the best games I've ever played.
That's the same order I played, because The Walking Dead's fucking legendary.
Yes.
Right? Everybody knows that.
Yes.
But The Wolf Among Us is arguably better.
I think it's 100 times better. I loved it.
Yeah.
I loved it. So I was really surprised.
I don't know if it like quite pulls at your heartstrings as much as Walking Dead is.
I would say it's more creative.
It's a better experience through all its episodes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's kind of my rapid fire was those games. I was really happily surprised with all of them.
I like fighting games. Right? Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
Street Fighter. I don't know if I've talked a lot about. That's an early part of my childhood. So you might resonate with this one because I know you've talked about this before. Dead or Alive 6.
Yeah!
Especially 6 is the shit. Actually, 5 is really good too. But 6 is kind of where, and I went back and played 5 after. But 6 came up on, I had the PlayStation Plus subscription or whatever. I'm like, I'm going to try this. I like fighting games or whatever. It is so fucking good. So good.
Fucking good.
Not just because
so
it's
fucking good.
Not just because it's jiggly or whatever.
Yeah.
Because there's lots of boobs and butts and whatever jiggling around that's sexified or whatever. But it's a legit like fighting game.
That is such a good one.
So good.
Because same. I don't know how I got into that game, but I got Dead or Alive 5. It was 5, not 6 for me.
Yeah.
And it just like I was like, this is the fighting game for me. You know, Party Trick, Zach and I were at a house party like last year and they had Dead or Alive 5 and I beat every single man at that party. And Zach was in the corner like, that's my bitch. I beat every single person because that was my game.
Who do you play as? Who's your main?
Who's the purple haired girl?
Ooh, man, I don't remember
Asumi?
Like any other names.
Asumi? Something like that, right?
Yeah, that sounds right.
She had the purple hair. She's my main for sure.
Okay.
Yeah, I love her. She's just...
Yeah.
Yeah, she's helicoptering and shit. Yeah. No, Kasumi is the girl with the orange hair, right? Shit. Okay.
I know who you're talking... Well, I think her name starts with an A, maybe. I know who you're talking about, though.
But the purple-haired girl.
Yeah.
Because she's also in Ninja Gaiden.
Yeah, she's like medium build.
Yeah. And you know, she's... Yeah.
Dude, that
phenomenal.
Game, yeah, that game's way more technical than people give it credit for because they think it's just this sexified
button mashing
thing.
But you can.
But it's like a tournament game.
Just the settings of the boobs.
Yeah, you can.
Don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
There's but that's not the whole point of the
There's
game.
A lot of jiggle. They even made that like offshoot. What's the
volleyball one?
Yeah. Where you can like oil them up and shit. You can like only get it in Japan. I don't even know. But they took like all the Dead or Alive characters and put them into like beach volleyball and
so good
some kind of life sim situation. But yeah, that game's awesome. It really is
so good. I love it.
And it's been forever since 6 came out.
Give us another.
I feel like we're due for 7.
Yeah.
I don't know. I haven't heard anything. So that was one that I like tried for free. That was like, man, this game's the shit.
Good one.
Few more that I have. Super Stardust Ultra, which is kind of like it's a Housemark game that makes like Returnal, Dead Nation, Alienation, my favorite indie studio ever, probably. Super Stardust Ultra is like an old school arcade like flight shooter thing, almost like Space Invaders type of thing. That game is super awesome. I actually played that on PS Vita. I had a Vita for a while.
I had a Vita too.
That was like the thing that I played the most.
Yeah.
Super Stardust Ultra.
Yeah.
Persona, obviously. That was like my first dive into like Japanese anime type of games, and now it's one of my favorite franchises ever, so Persona's got to be on the list. Shadow of the Colossus, someone recommended to me, and I thought it sounded dumb, honestly, because they were like, because the only way you can describe that game is, hey, you fight 12 bosses.
Yeah, that's how it was described to me, too. It's just boss fights. And I was like, that does not sound fun. Yeah,
and they're like, the rest of the game's like super empty. And it is. It is.
But it's phenomenal.
But you got to figure out your way to those bosses and taking them down heartbreaking. And
yeah, you can't describe that game any other way.
Yeah.
Like, it's only boss fights. That sounds like a horrible time, but it's actually amazing.
And that's what I thought. And that was one where I like borrowed the disc of it,
you know,
it was PS2, so they were like,
I played at my friend's house. They were like, try this game, it's only boss fights, and I was like, okay.
And that entire game is heartbreaking from beginning to the end because none of those kills are satisfying ever. So Shadow of the Colossus, I didn't think I'd like that because it sounded boring,
especially the bird.
You mentioned Until Dawn earlier. I had Until Dawn on my list because it's super cheesy and whatever slasher horror tropes, you know, not very creative. That's what I thought it was going to be. But I got totally sucked into that game.
Yes!
Such a good job with the decisions and the way the story played out, even though it was cheesy, was yeah. still super satisfying. So I have Until Dawn on my list.
It's cheesy in like a way that's like, they kind of call you on your bluff. They're like, this is the most cliche setting. We have the most cliche yeah. characters in a cabin in the woods with this cliche story. Can you survive it?
Stereotypical they call you characters, on your bluff. Like the whole thing is yeah. stereotypes. Because
when you watch movies, you're like, what an idiot. Why would he do that? They call you on your bluff with this game, which yeah. I respect so much.
Yeah, it's so good. I love it. It's still one of my favorite, like, choice-driven, whatever you call that genre.
Yes.
You
know,
interactive narratives or whatever, Until Dawn. And then, only because we talked about it earlier, I had Mad Max on my list. We were talking about the movie. If you haven't played that game, a lot of vehicular combat. That's one of the few licensed games that works, because it usually doesn't, right? Like, a movie comes out and they put out a game to go along with it.
Yeah.
Usually the game's shitty.
Yep.
Because they have to rush it out, and, you know, timing is of the essence with all that stuff. We have to put it out, you know, 1 week before the movie comes out or within 2 weeks of the movie coming out. But Mad Max is fucking killer. All right. Do you have anything else? No?
That's my list.
That's your list. So it is fun to be surprised, though.
Yeah. Pleasantly surprised.